So there's two stories I have to tell you all. The first one I like to think of sort of as a love story, and it happened to occur right here on Martha's Vineyard. The second, just to get you ready for it, is sort of a tragedy, but they're both intertwined. This is the Shenandoah. You might have heard this name before. She's an extreme clipper square topsail schooner. She has masts that are 94 feet above the water and enable her to carry 7,000 square feet of natural canvas sails. She's a reproduction of what is called a revenue cutter, which was essentially a government-sanctioned pirate ship. It would have sailed this coastline around the 1860s or later. But now, what Shenandoah was built for is overnight cruises out of Vineyard Haven. And every Sunday, 30 kids get on the boat at the beginning of the week and set out for a week-long trip, living, sleeping, and eating on board for the whole time. During that time, they're also shadowing the crew, helping in the daily maintenance and operation of the boat. And each night, the boat is spent in a protected harbor or cove, swinging calmly on her anchor. Now, the kids on Martha's Vineyard have it made because each summer, the fifth grade graduating class of each school gets to put together a week on Shenandoah. It just so happens that this program's been running for about 20 years, and in 1995, when I was a young lad on this island, I got to spend a week on the Shenandoah. To say that that week changed my life would be an understatement. As an 11-year-old, stepping aboard a boat like this is truly something transformative. It was, for me, like stepping into a time machine and coming out in a dream reality so wonderfully vivid that my mind would have never been able to even keep pace with it. There's the huge rig looming overhead, 50-something lines, all with their rightful purpose, descending down from the masts to their belaying pins or cleats. The masts, booms, spars, all with their respective tapers and symmetry. The smell of pine tar and linseed oil from handmade seasonings on deck. There's a place for everything. Everything is in its place. Nothing aboard is superfluous. Someone once told me simplicity is the watchword at sea. The more simplified things can be on a boat, the easier it is to fix if gear fails, and the less likely that gear is going to fail in the first place. On Shenandoah, for example, all the food is cooked on a coal stove with a fire that's kept burning all week long. Fresh water is stored in tanks below deck and hand-pumped by pumps into cups, wash basins, or sinks. The bunks and staterooms are small but adequate. Down below is primarily lit by kerosene lamps. There's two watertight doors and a 32-volt light in each cabin. But aside from that, there's very little aboard to cue you into what year it actually is. So you can imagine how somebody coming aboard can be transported away, both figuratively and literally. I certainly was. She was the most beautiful boat I had ever seen, and she called to me in a way that nothing else ever has. After my week-long trip with Oak Bluffs, I would return every weekend when the boat was in port and help the crew get the boat cleaned up and ready for the next trip. The captain liked me because I liked his ship, and he offered me a bunk on board when the boat wasn't full in one of the following weeks. I came back the next summer when I was 12, and spent 6 weeks working in the galley, washing dishes after each meal. I think it was hard to keep me down there. The cook, I remember chasing after me once in a while with a knife or spoon in hand, because as soon as I heard that the boat was getting ready to sail, I was out of there. The excitement of raising the sails and hauling the anchor was definitely too exciting to be missed. There was challenge and glory and adrenaline on the deck of Shenandoah, and I loved every minute of it. One of her eight sails, the Gansel, sets from about 80 feet above the deck. In order to set it and stow it, a crew member has to go aloft and stand on a half-inch wire foot rope, passing a line around the yard. Once the sail is readied, he calls down to the first mate on the deck, "Ready on the Gansel!" Once the first mate has everybody in their stations and he's ready from the deck, he yells up, "Throw it off!" And the sail is let go and comes billowing down from the yard. The corners are sheeted home as it fills with wind, and the yard is hoisted to its proper position with a crew member standing or sitting on top of it. So the first time I did this, I was shaking when my feet returned to the deck for the first time. But it's not the kind of shaking that cripples you. It was more of a celebration in my body and my mind of what I had actually just accomplished. Because I knew when I was up there that I was alone and that it was me and only me who would get the job done and me and only me who would either succeed or fail. We call this self-reliance, and it is something that the ocean demands of us in all its indifference. The next summer, I spent every day that I could on the Shenandoah. I left school a week early and returned in the fall a week late, with my teacher's permission. A few summers as crew member on that boat, and I was soon the most senior member of the crew. I was then promoted to second mate and then first mate. I served for 4 summers as Captain Bob Douglas's right-hand man, chief mate on the Shenandoah, and all the while another project had been in the works. There's me with Captain Douglas. That's a pretty funny photo. I found that in his photo album when I was getting ready to do this. It's like, I think that's perfect. So here's the Alabama. He bought her back in 1967, but it wasn't until about 30 years later that she would be rebuilt to join Shenandoah in the passenger trade. She's a reproduction of a Gloucester fishing schooner, which is, in my opinion, one of the most glorious and beautiful chapters of maritime history. She too, as you can see, has masts that touch the sky. She too is fitted out to carry almost 30 kids on week-long overnight excursions out of Vineyard Haven. She too was built to preserve and pass on the arts of traditional sailing, and she too requires a captain. When I was 24, I was asked to be the captain of this boat. This role is not one to be taken lightly. With a solid understanding of the dangers and risk involved in sailing that I had accumulated over the years, I knew that I was taking on by far the most responsibility I had ever had. The most essential definition of a captain's role is to ensure that the vessel and all its cargo are kept safe despite the inherent dangers of operating on the ocean. In the case of Alabama, the aforementioned cargo is kids, people. And with Alabama and Shenandoah, it's almost exclusively kids. Becoming a captain for me was sort of a paradox. You need a tremendous amount of experience on boats and on the ocean to be anywhere near prepared for something as complex and intricate as that to be in charge of. But the more experience you gain, the more awareness you have for how many things can potentially go wrong. It's an exploration in boundaries, breaking points, and dangers. And it teaches you more than anything how to manage risk. The biggest trial that I was ever faced with was the death of a crew member who was 18 years old and fell from the rig of the Alabama. This is the second story. His name was Ben Sutherland, and he was 18 years old when he was working on the boat in the summer of 2006. He was trying to lay across the boat's spring stay, which is a tension cable between the two masts you can see in this picture. The act of going across the spring stay doesn't serve a necessary part of sailing the boat, but if you want to get from one mast to the other quickly, and you're very comfortable in the rig and a little bit daring, it used to be pretty common for crew members to go across it if they were interested in doing so. When I looked aloft that day that we were sailing out in Vineyard Sound with a boat full of kids, I saw Ben up there. I had learned earlier that morning that he was interested in trying this out, going across the spring stay. And so I talked to the captain at the time, and we both decided that it was very important to talk to the crew and make sure that everybody understood that no one is to go aloft without direct permission from either the captain or the first mate, and that no one would be forced to do any jobs that they were not comfortable with up in the rig. So when I saw him up there that day, it was quite alarming. But at that point, there was really nothing that I could do to help him. He was most of the way across the stay, and from my vantage point, he was doing everything wrong. The first thing that I noticed is that he was going feet first toward the other mast. Not only does that make the physical motion awkward, but it means that once you get to your landing place, your whole lower body separates you from the mast, because when I say feet first, I'm talking about dangling your legs over the wire cable and, you know, shuffling yourself hand over hand across it. So your legs are supporting most of your body weight. The second thing is he was wearing shorts. Because it's a wire rope and a lot of your body weight is on your legs, they will inevitably be chafed if you don't have some kind of fabric protecting them. So there were several things that I think compounded for him, tiring him out most likely and making it very difficult, if not impossible, for him to land once he got to the other side. And so he fell, and there wasn't a single sound until his body hit the deck. I was the first person to reach Ben after he fell and check his vitals. I knew immediately in my mind that he was no longer with us. And it was a shocking day, to say the least. After the paramedics came and the body was carried off in a stretcher and all the passengers were taken off the boat and the boat was safely back on its mooring. In my mind, the horror that happened that day was really only a small part of the tragedy that would follow. The first thing that his fellow crew members had to do was to go into a doctor's office and take a drug test. So you can imagine your brain is reeling from what had happened that day, and you're still trying to make sense of what's actually going on, and you're being asked to pee into a cup. The second thing was that the Coast Guard sent some investigators down to the boat to find out what had happened, and they separated myself and the captain to lead them through the chain of events. It felt a lot like a police investigation because they were interested in hearing our stories separately, and then asked the crew members to give them their version of what had actually happened to make sure that everything was corroborated. So after the investigation, they promised that they would respond to what had happened and before long, and they did respond. And the first thing that was passed down is basically that no passengers would be allowed to climb in the rig of the Alabama or Shenandoah anymore. And there's a couple logical problems with that I have. The first, it wasn't a passenger, it was a crew member who fell from aloft. When passengers used to go up in the rig on the Shenandoah, they would usually climb up the ladder-like shrouds on the side of the mast to a comfortable height just to sort of take in the view and get a feel for what it was like being aloft. They certainly weren't laying across the spring stay or performing any of the difficult maneuvers that crew sometimes had to do up in the rigging. Not allowing passengers, people who paid to be there and aren't required but maybe would want the opportunity to experience what it's like to be aloft, doesn't seem like an appropriate response to me. The second thing that was odd is that they targeted not only the Alabama but the Shenandoah. Shenandoah was in her 42nd season at the time, which means she had carried approximately 10,000 passengers on week-long overnight cruises. 300 crew had worked on the boat and climbed in the rigging, all without any loss of life. There's also boats that exist that are far more similar to Alabama in the way the rig is put together than Shenandoah. So if you're going to target Shenandoah as well as Alabama, why stop there? So the response to me felt sort of like that of a crazed mob. We as a society often demand someone to pay for our losses even before sorting out the details and coming up with a productive response. In this case, the price was eliminating a huge portion of the boat, the most impressive parts from what the boat can offer in terms of experience for the passengers who paid to be there. People fall in love with sailing for many different reasons. You don't need to go aloft to experience the joy of sailing on these boats. You can certainly do it with your feet firmly planted on the deck. But for me, that experience was something that altered the course of my life forever. And to think that someone now wouldn't be able to do it is hard. Also, if that rule had existed that day, it wouldn't have stopped any of this from happening. So it doesn't really seem appropriate to me. The second problem that came from it was the financial costs. The parents of Ben Sutherland got him a job on the boat that summer because they were friends with the owner. His father was a professional ship model builder, and he had built some models of the most beautiful clipper ships that ever sailed. So his parents had a very solid understanding of what their son was getting into and what value could come from working on a boat like that, which is why they encouraged him to do it. Regardless of that, following the accidents, their lawyers, friends, or family encouraged them to sue. And the common thought is that, you know, your payout will settle outside of court for the maximum amount the insurance company is willing to pay, and the owners of the boat aren't badly harmed by this. What it does in actuality is drive insurance prices up, not just for this company, but for the whole industry. A sum like this will never equate to the cost of a young man's future, but what it does do is harm something that it would never set out to really make profit in the first place. There are 17 ships I know of right now, like the Alabama and Shenandoah, that are for sale, most for pennies on the dollar of their building costs. None of these boats were created because somebody, you know, figured that this was the best way to make a fortune. In fact, going to sea was never really the best way to do that. But they're for sale because these companies could not meet their overhead. So the consequences of an accident on the Alabama were not immediately crippling to the boats and their mission, but became part of a wall that is being built to keep us inside and shield us from the most powerful and life-changing experiences that exist. If a kid shows up on the dock today, enamored by the beauty and glory of the Shenandoah or Alabama, asking if there's an open berth, he has to be told to come back when he's 18 and apply for a job, because a kid that is not legally employed is too great a liability on the boat if he's working. If a kid sees a crew member up aloft setting the gansel from 80 feet above the deck and is interested in trying to climb up the rig himself, he has to be outright denied. Sort of like, sorry kid, the Coast Guard doesn't allow this. And it's becoming culturally unacceptable for someone to put themselves at risk, but we don't even have a clear view of where that risk exists. We tense up before we take off in on an airplane when the flight attendant is reading the safety card, but 1 in 20,000 people will die in a plane crash. At the same time, we drive down the road to the airport, answering phone calls, sometimes even texting a friend, and 1 in 100 people will die in a car accident. So we have this skewed perspective of what where risk actually exists and what actually threatens us. As far as these sailboats, only 5 people have ever died falling out of the rig of an American-flagged tall ship, to my knowledge. And 3 of them were on the U.S. Coast Guard Bark Eagle, a ship run by the exact branch of government that's out there to ensure safety at sea. We can't stop the media from honing in on our fears, but we can develop accurate understandings of where risk actually exists. Next time there's an accident or someone gets hurt or killed doing something that is challenging them to grow, learn, and build confidence in themselves, consider if there is anything to be gained by passing a law or mandate that limits us in what we can do. If you're being encouraged to sue someone because you're entitled compensation for a loss, consider if you would actually want your target to be eliminated, because in the long term, that's likely to be the outcome. I ask that people see the big picture. This kind of adventure program serves to build character in our youth, to build confidence in kids that are looking for a path, and to pass down skills that are incredibly valuable and could easily be forever forgotten. Sailing teaches us about our natural world, how powerful its elemental forces are, and how they can be so cunningly harnessed. It teaches us how effective working as a team toward a common goal can be. It teaches us the satisfaction of a hard day's work and simple things like cleaning up after yourself. It removes the trivial trappings of everyday life and replaces them with actual substance. There's risk in sailing, but that risk is what attracts many people to it in the first place. Risk is a critical component of all types of adventure programs. It's what makes them popular and successful. In fact, managing and mitigating risks is sort of the essence of what most of these programs are trying to teach. The greatest sailors are not the ones charging through a big sea with every sail set and the rig flexing to the edge of its strength. They're the ones like Captain Douglas, who kept everyone aboard Shenandoah safe for 42 seasons without eliminating the ability for people to take on challenges that serve their growth, build character and independence. The scariest thing to me about sailing a boat like Shenandoah or Alabama is not that someone will die when they climb aloft to set a topsail. It's that 10 years from now, the ship and all the life-changing experiences it has provided will be a memory, lasting only in photographs and stories passed down to the next generation of handcuffed risk takers. So here is my final plea. We must recalibrate our perception of risk before we as a society completely dismantle our greatest opportunities for education and growth. Where would we be without the Wright brothers, who took to the air in a homemade airplane, Buzz Aldrin, who fulfilled a promise to John F. Kennedy to land on the moon, and all the great takers of risk that have elevated humanity beyond what we believed it could have been? Thank you, that's all.